John Tripp. John is the man who organized our No Casino Somerset.
Bob Steele is chairman of Connecticut-based NLC Mutual Insurance Company and has been a director of numerous other companies, including CME Group and the American Stock Exchange. A graduate of Amherst College and Columbia University, he served in the CIA and Congress and was a nominee for governor of Connecticut. He comes to us this evening, however, as an author to speak about Connecticut's casino experience in the background to his novel, The Curse, Big Time Gambling Seduction of a Small New England Town. WBZ's Dan Rea calls the book powerful, and Connecticut author Martin Shapiro describes it as compelling and timely, a riveting story of history, money, and politics that will make you wonder where America is headed. Is a book I wish everyone in Somerset could read before agreeing to put a casino in our town.
Thank you very much. And I'm going to move this a little closer.
Yes.
I see it's as though we're in church. Everybody wants to sit in the back. I don't blame you. Any event, I'm delighted to be here. Thank you very much for your invitation. And I appreciate your interest in my book, which indeed is The Curse, Big Time Gambling Seduction of a Small New England Town. The book is a novel. It's set against the explosion of casino gambling in Connecticut back in the 1990s. Two Indian tribes built the world's two biggest casinos in the southeastern part of our state. The story begins with the Pequot War back in the 1600s, when the Connecticut colonists, all of whom had come from here in Massachusetts, got together with their Mohegan allies and defeated and almost destroyed the Pequots, who were the largest and most warlike of the Connecticut tribes. The story then jumps some 350 years as these two tribes, the Mashantucket Pequots and the Mohegans, reemerge almost miraculously, thanks to Congress and the courts, to build these two enormous enterprises. And in the book, a Connecticut family becomes embroiled in a battle to stop a third casino that threatens the family's town and ancestral home. So you may begin to see some parallels in the situation that you face here in Somerset. In any event, in the end of the story, a small, quintessential New England town faces a Faustian dilemma, whether to try to preserve its character and its values on the one hand, or accept an enormously seductive offer that would change the town forever. The Curse and Sum is a novel based on fact. And this evening I thought I'd focus on that factual background, both to give you an idea of some of the things you might want to be prepared for should a casino come to Somerset, and also because it was Connecticut's experience with casinos that really set the course for New England becoming a major center for casino gambling. In any event, I should probably start by giving you just a little bit of my own background because it figures into the book I wrote. But I did represent Eastern Connecticut in Congress back in the 1970s. And I represented almost all the towns east of the Connecticut River. I then left Congress to run for governor of Connecticut. I was unsuccessful, and at that point, my family, my wife and our four children, moved from Vernon, Connecticut. I don't know how well you know the geography of Connecticut, but up near Manchester. Moved from Vernon down to Ledger. years before Foxwoods arrived, or before anyone ever dreamed that casinos would come to southeastern Connecticut. In any event, those two experiences, knowing the political backdrop of Connecticut as intimately as I did, and then living in the midst of this casino explosion, gave me a front row seat for watching the political maneuverings that led to the casinos, and then seeing firsthand their impact. Indian casinos got their start back in 1988 when Congress passed something called the Indian Gaming Regulatory Act. The act was meant to help poor, federally recognized Indian tribes build casinos on their reservations in order to raise money to support their tribal governments. I know we're not talking about an Indian casino here, but could well be talking about one not so far from here. In any event, I tell you that because it would be fair to say that Congress, when it passed this law, had absolutely no idea of the Pandora's box it was opening when it passed the act. As it turned out, this act in 1988 not only opened the door to tribal casinos, but it also spurred the legalization and the opening of non-Indian, commercially owned casinos across the United States as well. Back in 1988, when this law was passed, there were only two states that allowed casinos: Nevada, obviously with Las Vegas, and New Jersey with Atlantic City. Today, 40 states allow casinos, and America is now awash in casinos. We now have almost 1,000 of them, just about equally divided between Indian casinos and commercially owned casinos. As a result, casino gambling has literally become America's new national pastime, with more people going to casinos than to professional baseball, football, baseball, hockey, soccer, and you can throw in any other professional sport you're aware of combined. That's how big it has become. And nowhere in the last 25 years did it become bigger, faster than in Connecticut. Foxwoods opened back in 1992 in Ledyard, and Mohegan Sun opened in 1996, 8 miles away in the town of Montville. They were the first casinos in the Northeast outside of Atlantic City, and with no other competition, they quickly grew to be the two biggest casinos in the world, attracting well over half their customers from other states, mainly New York and Massachusetts, but from all over the Northeast, creating 23,000 casino jobs and beginning to send hundreds of millions of dollars a year to the state treasury in Hartford. It's truly one of the most amazing stories in the history of New England. These two tribes, the Mashantucket Pequots and the Mohegans, once mortal enemies trying to destroy each other, then gradually fading away for hundreds of years until there's almost no more Indian blood left, no more Indian culture. And yet reemerging thanks to our political system to build these two huge enterprises. Great story, right? Except, of course, the story is not over. And with every passing year, we're learning more and more about the downside of what has happened in Connecticut. The casinos have created a pervasive gambling culture in southeastern Connecticut. They've skewed the region's economy heavily toward low-wage service jobs. And they've been followed by a sharp spike in the number of Connecticut residents seeking treatment for gambling addiction.
Thank you.
one of the most remarkable findings from the 2009 State of Connecticut study was that there had been a 400% increase in the number of arrests for embezzlement in Connecticut after the casinos arrived. A rate of increase 10 times the national average. One of the embezzlers, incidentally, was actually my tax collector. And she stole $302,000 from tax receipts in order to play the slots at Foxwoods. I never knew whether my tax receipts were among them or not, but I always figured they probably were. In any event, of course, she didn't win. Because over time, nobody wins. It is statistically impossible. When the casino takes 10% of everything you bet, if you gamble long enough, it is impossible to win. You might hit a jackpot, you might get extraordinarily lucky, but if you keep going, you're going to lose it. Recent embezzlement stories in Connecticut range from a Bridgeport Elementary School principal allegedly taking $10,000 in student funds to gamble at Mohegan Sun, to the story of the chief financial officer in the little town of Winchester, Connecticut, up in the northwestern corner of Connecticut, who managed over a period of 5 years, and I still can't understand how he managed to do it, but he managed to steal over $2 million from the town, much of which he lost at the two casinos. The embezzlement was so big that it literally brought the town of Winchester to its knees. Right up until Christmas time, it was talking about having to close the school system in Winchester because they had run out of money. Looking at crime overall, a 2014 study, it's a brand new study, just came out a couple months ago, from Western Connecticut State University. Probably you haven't heard about this one. 2014 study that shows the number of violent crimes, including murder, rape, robbery, and aggravated assault, increased in the towns surrounding Foxwoods and Mohegan Sun after the casinos opened, despite a sharp drop in crime throughout the state of Connecticut and throughout the country as a whole. While the value of property stolen and theft crime skyrocketed by nearly 40%. According to the study's author, interviews with local police and judicial officials also indicated increases in crimes such as prostitution and illicit drug use. As far back as 1997, that's a long time ago, gosh, we're almost talking pretty soon, it'll be 18 years ago, it'll be 20 years ago pretty soon. As far back as 1997, Congress, which had opened the door to this casino explosion, became so concerned about what it had done and the spread of casino gambling that it set up a national commission to study the issue. I suppose you could say, what else would you expect from Congress but to set up a commission? But in all fairness, the commission worked pretty hard for 2 years and made a number of recommendations, the most important of which was that there be a moratorium on the building of new casinos in the United States until the federal government could get a better handle on the social and economic costs. Needless to say, though, from what I've already said, that recommendation was never passed. It seems that the casino industry didn't think it was a very good idea. So in the process, the casino industry has exploded across the country. Casino gambling has become a $67 billion industry, one of the most powerful political groups in the United States, something that you're beginning to experience here in Somerset. The casino industry contends that casinos spur economic development, that they create jobs, and that they provide states and municipalities with much needed revenue. That's the gist of the argument. That's why they think they should be able to come in to community after community across America. But the opponents of casino gambling have long argued that casinos do far more harm than good. They begin with the facts that casino gambling, after all, is addictive for millions of people. and that gambling addiction leads to debt, bankruptcies, broken families, and crime. Second, opponents reject the contention that casinos promote economic development. Pretty important. That's what they're going to do. They're going to remake Fall River, remake your community. In Kinetic's case, the opponents, however, point out that the casinos have done little. These are two very big casinos. Have done little to create spin-off businesses, but instead have cannibalized existing businesses and left Connecticut residents with billions of dollars less to spend on other goods and services. Just so it doesn't sound too theoretical, let me give you an example of cannibalization. It actually involved a very good friend of mine who owned and operated one of the most successful restaurants in southeastern Connecticut. And I remember how excited he was when Mohegan Sun opened a couple miles up the road. And I remember him telling me that he was sure that with all these people coming down from Boston and up from New York and over from Albany and over from Providence, surely, he thought, hundreds of these people every month, if not every week, would stop at his restaurant, maybe to have lunch before they went to have a good day's gambling, maybe to have dinner on the way home. Or maybe some of these 23,000 employees at the end of the day, at the end of their shift, would want to come in, maybe have a drink at the bar, maybe have a bite to eat after a tough day's work. As I recall, it took just about 31 months. Didn't happen immediately, but it took about 31 months for him to decide to close his restaurant. And I'll never forget what he told me when he told me he was going to close it. He said, "You know, Bob, I cannot believe how naive I was about the way the casinos work. But now I understand. People drive to the casinos, they play at the casinos, they go to shows at the casinos, they stay at the casino hotels, they eat at the casino restaurants, and then they fill up their gas tanks at the casino gas stations and drive home. We, as local merchants, as local business people, rarely, if ever, see any of these people." As casino mogul Steve Wynn, who of course is going to build a casino up in Boston, once told a group of Bridgeport, Connecticut businessmen when he was trying to get them to agree and getting the state legislature to agree for him to build a casino in Bridgeport, which they did not agree to, but he was pitching them. And he said the following. It's one of the things that I must say I do like about Steve Wynn. He's very blunt. And here's what he told these Bridgeport businessmen as they sat in the audience, just as you're sitting here listening to me now. "Get it straight," he told them. "There is no reason on earth for any of you to expect for more than 1 second that just because people come to my casino, they're going to run into your stores or your restaurants." Third, opponents say there is little evidence that casinos ultimately strengthen a state's or a municipality's finances. Connecticut, they note, receives 25% of the casino's slot machine revenue. That has provided the state over the last 20 years with almost $7 billion. Almost $7 billion in shared slot revenue going to the Connecticut State Treasury. Yet today, Connecticut is in the worst financial shape in its history, with a lagging economy and the third worst debt and unfunded liability ratio of any state in the United States. And now, an independent group of scholars assembled by the American Institute, by the Institute for American Values in New York, one of the leading think tanks in the United States, has recently published a study that looks at the impact the casino explosion has had and is having on the nation as a whole. And I thought you'd be interested in their findings. One, once an occasional and largely upper-class activity, casino gambling has moved from the margins to the mainstream of American life. Two, today's regional and local casinos, such as what they want to put here in Somerset, are different from traditional Vegas-style casinos that catered predominantly to well-heeled players who came from long distances away and preferred table games. In contrast, new casinos are primarily slots barns, filled with a new generation of highly addictive slot machines and cater overwhelmingly to middle and low rollers who live within an hour away, return frequently, and play the slots. Three, modern slot machines have transformed American gambling. Slots are no longer the one-armed bandits of old. And indeed, if any of you have played a slot machine recently at a casino, you know that today's slot machines don't even have arms anymore. They literally electronically tether you to your account and through it, your credit card, I suppose you could say. According to a new MIT study by a brilliant professor there by the name of Natasha Scholl, who has written a study entitled, the title kind of gives it away, it's called Addiction by Design. According to Natasha Scholl, the modern versions of these older slot machines have become sophisticated computers, engineered to create fast, continuous, and repeat betting, designed to get players to gamble longer and lose more over time. And I want to put thousands of those in your time. Four, while casinos represent themselves as benign entertainment companies, I mean, they must be benign entertainment companies. I mean, here, I'm just reading this article from your Herald News. Karam touts Somerset as great fit for casino. It must be a benign business, or he wouldn't want to come to your town, I'm sure. But while the casinos represent themselves as benign companies, entertainment companies, they are in fact predatory businesses that depend on problem gamblers, that is people with some level of gambling addiction, for 35 to 60% of their profits. But just think about that for a minute. We now have 11 excellent studies from Australia, Canada, the United States, the UK, that show that 35 to 60% of the profits generated by these machines come from addicted gamblers. Five, living within 10 miles of a casino more than doubles the chance of developing a gambling addiction. Six, casinos constitute a regressive tax that hits low-wage earners, minorities, and the elderly the hardest, thereby contributing to economic inequality in America. Where have you heard that term before? It's only supposedly the biggest political issue in America, both the Democrats and the Republicans. All I can talk about, economic inequality. According to the study, casinos are an important contributor to economic inequality because of the people who go largely to the casinos, and particularly because of the slot machines. And incidentally, you might be interested to know that one of the fastest growing groups of addicted gamblers in America are actually women. Women aged anywhere from 50 to 85 who are particularly drawn to slot machines. Because, according to the research, it's not my research, according to the research, they particularly like the opportunity to gamble in isolation. They don't have to tell anybody. They like the security of the casinos, which is excellent. They feel safe in the casino, at least until they go out into the parking lot. And thirdly, they like the hospitality of the casinos. Free wine, casinos bend over backwards, the bus trips, the discount, or in some cases, free lunches. And there is no question that casinos are extremely hospitable to older people, especially at Social Security time. Finally, state sponsorship, this is their seventh finding, state sponsorship of gambling is a conflict of interest for state governments and municipal governments that are established to promote the general welfare, not prey on their citizens by encouraging them to gamble. In sum, according to this landmark study, and I have some copies, and I'd be happy to give copies to anybody who would like one of this study, but according to the study, the long-term costs of the new regional and local casinos exceed their benefits by 3 to 1. They drain wealth from communities, weaken nearby businesses, hurt property values, and reduce civic participation, family stability, and other forms of social capital that are at the heart of a successful community like Somerset. Now, despite the costs, the conventional wisdom in Connecticut has been that Connecticut's casinos have been a net economic plus for the state of Connecticut because of their success in attracting so many people from out of state who leave their money in Connecticut. That is, they bring new money from outside the state to the state. So the assumption is, well, it's got to be a plus for the state economically. We don't really know whether they have or not because the study has never been done. But what we do know is that the regional monopoly that allowed Connecticut's casinos to attract so much out-of-state money has now disappeared as the Northeast has become increasingly saturated with casinos. When Foxwoods opened back in 1992, there were only 10 other casinos in the entire 12 states of the Northeast. And all of them were in Atlantic City, 250 miles away. Today, there are 53 casinos in the 12 states of the Northeast, and the number could easily go to over 70 based on those approved or under construction already. As a result of the growing competition, particularly from Rhode Island's Twin River Casino and the slots casinos, the huge electronic slots casinos at Aqueduct and Yonkers racetracks in New York, the combined revenue for Connecticut's casinos has already declined 39% from its peak. This is what happens when it starts down. The two casinos have now laid off 8,000 workers between the two of them. They are now and have been increasingly replacing full-time jobs with part-time jobs in order to reduce wage costs and get rid of medical benefits. Well, Foxwoods has stopped all profit sharing with its tribal owners and has defaulted on $500 million worth of its debt. The same downward trend, as you know, from just reading the papers, same downward trend is underway elsewhere. For example, Delaware has now put tens of millions of dollars toward bailing out its three casinos, while New Jersey has spent hundreds of millions of dollars trying to prop up its casinos, only to see one-third of them close in the last 14 months. In Ohio and Maryland, and I mention this because this is what they tell you when it's on the come, what it's going to do. In Ohio and Maryland, casino revenue is roughly 40% already below original projections. So take it with a grain of salt, whatever they tell you the Somerset Casino is supposed to produce. Back in Connecticut, Foxwoods and Mohegan Sun say they have absolutely no intention of sitting back and watching all this competition eat their lunch. What they say they plan to do is to upgrade their properties and add new attractions in order to continue attracting as many out-of-staters as possible. But it's unlikely large numbers of out-of-staters will continue traveling all the way to eastern Connecticut when they have a brand new casino closer by. Instead, Connecticut's casinos will have to increasingly turn inward and depend on attracting more and more in-state people to gamble. Now, I know what some of you may be thinking. Well, too bad for Connecticut. Look at all that money you took in over these last few years. But my message to you is, Can you really expect anything different here from what we have experienced now in Connecticut? Connecticut, if nothing else, has been a laboratory experience for what others can expect. Now, at this point, you might think that Connecticut and other states would begin to recognize the short-sightedness of depending on gambling revenue for their improving and maintaining their economy. And instead would begin to make a serious effort, one, to control spending, and two, to develop more stable and less problematic sources of revenue. But that, of course, would be too much to ask. And that is not what is happening. Instead, state after state, including Connecticut, is seeking to expand legalized gambling, either to increase its gambling revenue or to replace the gambling revenue it's losing to all this new cross-border competition. In Connecticut, the state began by increasing the casino's free play allowance so the casinos could beef up promotions and attract more people to come in and play. The state tried to legalize keno for convenience stores, bars, and restaurants before being forced to abandon the effort by strong public opposition. And now, casino supporters in the legislature have introduced a bill, and they just passed it in the first committee, a bill to permit the Mashantucket Pequots and the Mohegans to jointly build 3 new commercial satellite casinos in Connecticut in the hope of keeping state gamblers from going where? To Massachusetts and to New York and to every other state that now has gambling, and thereby preserve casino jobs and casino revenue. So we've made the transition. Now it's all about how can we begin to slow this exodus of casino jobs and money. The 2 tribes, the Mashantucket Pequots and the Mohegans, want to open the first of their so-called satellite convenience casinos north of Hartford, near the Massachusetts border, in order to intercept gamblers tempted to go to the new MGM casino in Springfield. While they're looking at the Bridgeport and Danbury areas for the 2nd and 3rd casinos in order to stop people from going to New York. As one wag said, why go to all this trouble? Why not just arrest Connecticut people who are trying to go to these other states? The Hartford area casino would have up to 2,000 slot machines and 50 to 75 table games, which means it would primarily be what? What they're all becoming, a big slots parlor. The convenience casinos would do nothing to bring back out-of-state gamblers, customers to Connecticut, but they would encourage current Connecticut gamblers to gamble more, more frequently, and of course would create thousands of new Connecticut gamblers. And finally, thanks to a 2011 U.S. Justice Department ruling, New Jersey, Nevada, and Delaware have now legalized in-state online gambling for their casinos. And other states are considering legalizing it as well. Casinos like Foxwoods and Mohegan Sun want it in order to attract younger people, who, of course, are technologically primed for internet gambling. While addiction experts view it as especially addictive because of the fast pace of the games, their 24-hour availability, and the instant gratification aspect of online gambling, which I am told is particularly attractive to younger people. In conclusion, the lesson from Connecticut and the lesson from what's happening across the country is that gambling breeds more gambling. Gambling creates constant pressure to constantly expand gambling. And as I say, it is very difficult to believe that your experience will be any different from ours. the massive further expansion of legalized gambling across the United States, across New England, across Connecticut, is a daunting prospect for those who think we already have enough of it. In fact, for me, the entire remarkable story about casinos in Connecticut was enough to want to write a book. Thanks very much for having me. And I would be happy to do my best to answer your questions. Yes.
If the casinos have brought in so much money into Connecticut, why is it so broke? Is it mismanagement funds on a government level?
Well, one of the things that has happened is everybody thought this was free money. When you think it's free money, you're a lot less careful about spending. And Connecticut went on a huge spending spree. And as I say, one of the things that we do need to do in Connecticut is get our runaway spending out of control. It is a matter of that, and it is also a matter of finding stable sources of and reliable sources of revenue, which now we have to do. You know, you become increasingly, just like an addict, you become increasingly addicted to the money. Even worse is the situation in Rhode Island right now. You know that 12% of Rhode Island's revenue budget comes from gambling? 12%? What is going to happen to the state of Rhode Island once Massachusetts opens these casinos? It's facing a major budget crisis. That's the best answer I can give you. Yes, sir.
Casinos that are done in Connecticut are Indian, so they have some tax breaks. Are the ones they're bringing in here going to have the same tax breaks as the or are they going to...
I don't know if you all heard that question, but the question was, what's the difference between Indian casinos and the kind of casinos that are opening here in Massachusetts? The Indian casinos, the Indian tribes on their reservations are autonomous, semi-autonomous nations. They have their own government. Serious crimes are dealt with by the state police, but other crimes have their own courts, they have their own police force, etc. And the agreement that Connecticut made with the tribes was that Connecticut would allow them to have slot machines if they would send 25% of their slot revenue to the state of Connecticut. So that's what they do. They don't pay anything for their table game revenue, but 25%, which is a pretty hefty amount. Here in Massachusetts, the program has been to tax casino revenue across the board. And of course, Massachusetts has said, well, look, everybody's always smarter than the next guy, right? Well, look, we're going to do it right, Massachusetts, right? We're going to do it right, and we're going to mitigate all the problems. This is the only industry, incidentally, in the world that comes into your town and says, look, we are going to create so many problems that we are going to mitigate them. We are going to give you X amount of money to mitigate your problem. We're going to mitigate doesn't mean stop. I mean, we're going to lessen these problems. In other words, they come in from the beginning acknowledging the problems. To some degree, they don't tell you what I just told you tonight. That's for sure. But they say, look, we're going to mitigate the problems, and unfortunately, it's very, very difficult to mitigate the kinds of problems they create. So that's the difference. I just want to ask somebody who I haven't called on, if I may. I'll come back. Yes, all the way in the back. It's a little bit hard for me to hear up here.
My mother. And where Mohegan Sun is, Uncasville is a village in Montville.
Yeah.
And she has a different perspective about the casino. She does not like the casino. One of the things is the jobs that were promised, and especially the younger workers, because it is kind of an isolated part of Connecticut. So if you were young and unskilled, it was tempting to think you could work at the casino, but many of them could not get bonded. So they weren't capable of working at the casino because whatever the bonding process was, most of the young people that she knew who applied were not able to get in. The second thing is they had their own dormitories. So a lot of times that they would take young people from overseas and house them in the dormitories and pay them less than minimum wage because they were giving them lodging. And third of all, the town of Montville has had their tax revenue from the casino cut in half because they say that they cannot afford to give them what they had promised them when they built the casino.
Well, when we got our casinos in Connecticut, we never had any choice. We never had a vote. Congress decided, the courts decided, there was kind of a peripheral vote about a Las Vegas Knights charity gambling law that figured in, but we didn't go to the polls and vote whether we wanted casinos. Nor at that time am I sure we would have been smart enough to know what was coming. Most people had no idea. Now, and as a result, unlike in Massachusetts, there was almost no town-by-town mitigation. Rather, the money that was the 25% that was going to the state said it would redistribute some of that money to the towns and cities. But the local communities like Montville got very, very little. One thing is certain, and this is happening, you can get a Google alert on almost anything, as I'm sure most of you know. And it takes me at least a couple hours a day just to read the stuff that comes in on Google alerts on casinos. But you see it from all over the country. State after state, casino after casino, the casinos going to the state capitol. And what do they start arguing? We need lower taxes. We need to be open 24 hours a day. We need to be able to serve alcohol at all times. We need to get rid of the smoking ban because people don't like to gamble unless they can smoke. We're paying too much in taxes, etc., etc., etc. Asking for reduced regulation. Even in Pennsylvania, I was just reading, just the last couple days, here's Pennsylvania, which has now become the second biggest casino state in the United States after Nevada. And everybody was cheering about all the great things and all the money that they're bringing in. Now 12 of the 14 casinos, the leaders from those casinos, they just came back from the state capitol asking for reduced regulation. I guarantee you that will be your experience here in Massachusetts. They will want more benefits. They will want to pay less taxes. They will want to be open hours that are best for them. They will want online gambling. I guarantee it. Not because they're bad people, because they're business people, and their business starts going down, and they need help. They need to be bailed out, as in Delaware, as in New Jersey, now what we're seeing in Connecticut, etc. So I can understand what you were told about Montville, and what you heard is true. Yes, sir.
When a casino is proposed, and it gets closer and closer to the time where the casino is going to be built, which method do they use? The developers, do they use impact studies or do they use cost benefit studies?
Good question. Here's the thing I'll say, and I don't know what kind, you haven't had a study yet here, I guess it's too new. But here's what will happen. They'll come in and they will tell you, they'll hire somebody who's done this before from other communities, who has a reputation as an analytical company that analyzes casino impact. And they will tell you, here's the number of jobs, construction jobs, permanent jobs, the amount of revenue that you can expect, the number of people who will be hired from the community or the immediate community, etc. That's what they'll tell you. They'll say nothing about the downside. Oh, they will say one thing. They'll say, look, we're going to provide you some money to mitigate problems. But they're not going to tell you what those problems are. So you're going to hear all about jobs, you're going to hear all about revenue, and you're going to hear all about remaking your community for the better. You're not going to hear the things that I just told you tonight, that's for sure. Yes, sir, in the back.
This is an article that came in the Boston Globe about a year ago. Talks about Connecticut casinos employ hardball tactic to collect debts. And it speaks to an 80-year-old man, retiree, who Mohegan Sun put a lien on his house because he couldn't pay back the $36,000 that Mohegan Sun had fronted him to gamble there. And there's a whole, there's like 16 houses in Rhode Island that have liens on them as a result of Mohegan Sun and Foxwoods going after them. The particular individual, Mr. Cutler, actually passed away 4 years after they had put the lien on there, and he still, you know, so now the heirs, the family, has to help and repay the debt. So, and this Mark Arsenault, who used to write for the Providence Journal, now writes for the Globe and does a lot of stories on casinos, and he says that, in his opinion, Mohegan Sun and Foxwoods are the two most aggressive casinos in the United States for going after people like this. So I wondered if you had any comments on that or thoughts about that?
Yeah, I'm familiar with the article, the Boston Globe did that research. Recounted it accurately. I wouldn't say Mohegan Sun and Foxwoods are the two most aggressive, but they are among the most aggressive. There is no question about that. I spoke at the, I don't know if you know where Sprague, Connecticut. Sprague is just north of Norwich. I spoke at the library there a few months ago, and the librarian of the Sprague Library told me afterwards, she said, we have three families on one street who have lost their houses to the casinos. And I just assumed, it must be a pretty long street, and I said something to her. She said, it's true. She said, the road is about 2 miles long. I'll tell you another story. Story I heard about up in Connecticut, not far from the casinos. Story about a boy who was seriously overweight and as a result was not very popular with the other kids, kind of ostracized. But the football coach spotted him and said, listen, why don't you come on the team? You know, you'd make a great tackle or a great guard on the football team. And he came on the team, he lost some weight, he loved it, and he was their star lineman. And the team decided to take up a collection to buy some football equipment. And because this boy had become very popular, they gave him the assignment of being chairman of this fund drive. And they raised money, they raised several hundred dollars, and he kept it at home in a box. His mother and father were avid gamblers. And they stole the money. And they lost it at the casinos. And he loved his mother and father. And he refused to say all the money had disappeared. And they kicked him off the team. Now, I don't really tell you that to pull heartstrings, but I do tell you that just to give you a feel that you have no idea of the number of stories and people who are impacted in one way or another. Nobody has any full understanding of that. The person who told me that was the executive director of one of the social agencies in Connecticut. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
You mentioned the satellite, the Mohegan, the Mohegans and the Pequots are trying to form satellite casinos. Are they looking at isolated areas of those particular satellite locations, like their main facilities, or is it smack dab in a residential area like in our town? So you have a selectman that thinks that's a heavy commercial area. We have neighborhoods that run down 103 and go deep into Brayton Point, and we have neighborhoods that run down Brayton Point Roadway and go deep the other direction.
Well, in Connecticut, what they're looking for is they want to be close to I-91, I-95, or I-84. And what they're talking about is in the Windsor-Enfield area, residential towns, or in the Danbury area, or in Bridgeport. Bridgeport, obviously, one of our biggest cities. So it's all over the lot. But I have never heard of very many cases in which casinos that want to locate are very squeamish about where they go. Look, they go near schools, they go near this, they go near that. They want to go wherever there is a place that they can get in. It's not that easy to get into, you know, to find suitable land. So they will look for that land. But the main thing is to be near highways somewhere. So it's, you know, 5 minutes off the highway or 10 minutes off the highway, but as close to the highways as possible. That's what the experience. I'm sorry, you had a question.
The money that's generated by, I'll say, the slots, goes to the state. How much of that money comes back to Somerset? You mentioned they disperse it across towns, across the state, but how much of that money would be, I'll say, promised back to this town?
Well, I was talking about the situation in Connecticut. Here in Massachusetts, the town has to make an agreement with the host community. In this case, it would be Somerset. And it would negotiate with your town leaders and say, we'll give you X, and town would say, no, give us Y, etc. And they would come to some kind of agreement if the casino were to come into town. They would have to come to some kind of agreement. Also, in all the other towns in Massachusetts, there's had to have a referendum in the host community. So I know you've got several steps here. You've got the zoning question, you've got the referendum question, etc. And I'm not an expert on exactly how it would play out, obviously, in Somerset. But there is that difference. In Connecticut, as far as these satellite casinos are concerned, they're not even talking about giving the communities a vote. They're talking about the legislative bodies of the host communities making the decision. In other words, a few elected leaders instead of the population, which has been a huge problem in New York. That's exactly what happened in New York, and it caused all kinds of problems. Yes, sir.
I find I know a couple of proponents of this. I find it interesting that people think that, this Somerset Casino is going to attract people from the Cape, from Mattapoisett, from Marion, from Fall River that would otherwise go make the drive to Connecticut. And it seems to me that a casino in Somerset would be more of a bare bones type casino. It's not going to have the attractions and the beauty of Mohegan Sun and Foxwoods. So I just find that an interesting argument by the proponents.
You said it, but casinos are being built all over the world today. The biggest casino mecca now is Macau in China, but Singapore is becoming a close second. Korea wants to build new casinos. Japan wants to build casinos. You know, one of the first things Putin did when he came when he took over the Crimea, they declared it a casino zone. That bring in casino people to come in and play. Everybody wants casino. I want to build casinos in Mongolia. Well, all of these glamorous places, Macau, Singapore, Las Vegas, why would any high roller get on a plane and want to come to Somerset to gamble? And I don't say, you're lucky. Anyone that wants to come to Ledger to gamble anymore. You know who your gamblers will be. They'll be from a half an hour's radius around. And what has happened, and according to the study, and the study's made the point, is in the past, people used to get on an airplane, travel a long way. Maybe they go to Las Vegas, even if they were aficionados of gambling. Maybe they go to Las Vegas twice a year. Now what you've got, because these casinos are on Main Street, they're everywhere, you've got people going 2 and 3 times a week, especially sitting mindlessly at those slot machines, shoving their money, or in this case, electronically, into them. These are local casinos for local people who gamble frequently, increasingly. Now, in the summer, I suppose, I mean, you're in a very strategic area, people go into the Cape, and go people here, and go there, but you've got this huge, grandiose casino that's going to be built up in Boston. You've got these two huge casinos in Connecticut. I don't think you're going to find great urgency to come to Somerset to gamble. Yes, sir.
This lady asked a question about taxes.
Taxes,
now,
yeah.
How does Massachusetts get paid? Obviously, they tax casinos. Is that just a percentage? And then the state decides how much they're going to give us? You mentioned that.
The state, that's exactly right.
Let's say you tax 50%, then let's say if it's 50%, our town will negotiate with the state?
Well, in Massachusetts, each town does, each casino would have to negotiate with the town. So the town, the host town, would get money over and above what money might be distributed by the state. But look, you've been a great audience. Let me just, one question I frequently get is, why did I write the book as a novel instead of as a nonfiction book? The answer to that is we've had two very good books in Connecticut on the rise of Foxwoods because it was such a huge national story. And I didn't think there was any need to write another nonfictional book. But what I did want to do was write the story of what happened in Connecticut. For my children, for people in Eastern Connecticut, and especially for people elsewhere, because even by the time I get to Hartford, most people don't know exactly what happened in Eastern Connecticut. By the time I get to Massachusetts, almost nobody knows, or to New York, or to New Jersey, etc. And it is a remarkable story, and I thought that if I could write the factual story as part of an exciting novel against a exciting story, that I could attract a much larger audience. And I could put a human face on what happens when a casino comes to a community. I hope I have achieved that. The book has just gone into its second printing. Shirley did ask me to bring some books. I did. I'd be happy to sign one for anyone who would like one. And I want to thank you again very much for inviting me here and wish you all the very best in your fight. Thank you.
On Tuesday, April 14th, 7 o'clock right here, same building, Mr. Les Bernal, National Director of Stop Predatory Gambling, will be joining us. I'm sure you won't want to miss the second talk. So together with this one, you'll be able to make a more informed decision about whether having a casino with Somerset is justifiable ethically and economically. Thank you and good night. July 14th.